Good morning, everyone. How are we doing? Oh, that's not. This is weak. We need to spruce this up. Good morning, everyone. There we go. All right. Welcome to Red Oak Church. Listen, if you were not at the open mic this past Friday, I'm going to tell you missed out. We had a great time. It was a lot of fun, a lot of laughs. And so also one of the other things that we're going to be doing is on the 10th, there's going to be a game night. Friday night, the 10th, Friday night, the 10th, yes. And so just, again, you'll see in your bulletin or scrolling on the screen all the announcements. Just know we're going to be very intentional about ways that we can gather and enjoy each other's company and have some fellowship in the Lord, especially when it's long, cold winters. Now, this winter has got me a little confused, okay? I don't know if anybody else is a little confused. I went from feeling this is the warmest winter I've ever felt in my life with high 40s to this is the coldest winter I've ever felt in my life. And I just looked at the forecast and I might go back to this is the warmest winter I've ever felt in my life. So with that being said, we're going to try to make sure that we have ways that we can get together. And so as we grow, that's so important. I just really want to encourage everybody, look in the bulletins, look at the screens, find ways that we can plug in, because as this church grows, one thing we don't ever want to lose is that sense of church family and that sense of community in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
All right, Eric, are you ready to give us the call to worship?
Yes, I'm ready.
He's ready and excited and willing. Let's stand up and do the call to worship.
Thank the Lord for all of us being here today.
Amen.
The call of worship this morning is taken from Psalm 9, 1, 2. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds.
I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Before we start this song, I just feel like there's something I want to say. There are like two themes that run side by side in this hymn. One is the privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And that kind of repeats over and over again throughout this hymn about going to God in prayer. And the other one is what a friend we have in Jesus. It's almost like there's two songs about the privilege of prayer and about the friend that we have in Christ. But the more you understand prayer, the more you realize it's like going to a friend. It's like going to our Lord. It's like going to our Master. It's like going to our Savior. But it's also going to a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there. Amen. Amen. Somebody tell me something you are grateful for today. Sunshine. Sunshine. All right. What else? Come on, let's liven this place up.
I'm grateful for I got the good news that the doctor is going to work on my eyes.
The doctor is going to work on your eyes. Amen. I know we've been praying about that, Eric. What else? Anyone? Forgiveness. Amen. Jesus. Amen. Service. Amen. For being here. God bless you all. Listen, I want you to know that there's going to be a time of prayer afterwards, okay? And it's not going to be kind of the normal call forward. I was talking a little bit with someone before the service about this. And today's theme, I'm going to get this right out of the gate so you all know. Today's topic is about dealing with confrontation and conflict. And it's not an easy topic, and probably some of you want to head for the back doors right now and say, I don't want to deal with confrontation. But we're going to have a time of prayer afterwards. And, you know, there's no secret reason why this needed to come up, okay? It's just, if we learn a different way than what we see, imagine what a light that would be. If we learn a different way than we see, imagine what a light that would be. That's a rhyme I didn't intentionally make, but we'll run with that. And so there's going to be some time of prayer. I want to encourage you to. I also, Jennifer Holloway is going in for surgery on Monday, tomorrow, and we're going to have a time where we're going to pray for you. Anybody's welcome. She mentioned to me just recently, said you wanted to open up for anybody to come. And so just know right now we're going to bathe this moment in prayer. We're going to bathe after the service in prayer. And I want every single one of us to be open to what the Holy Spirit might do in your life today. Amen? Yeah. All right.
Joy of the Lord is our strength.
This next song has a weird lyric into it. If you didn't understand the point of this song, you might say, why is this even in here? It says, find me in the river, find me there. Find me on my knees with my soul laid bare. Even though you're gone and I'm cracked and dry, find me in the river. I'm waiting here for you. You know, I think there's those moments when we hit our knees and pour out our soul before God. If you haven't done that, I want to say to you, I have found it in my life to be one of the most liberating moments that I've experienced. You ever get just tired of yourself? Absolutely tired of yourself. Like, ugh, me again. In those moments that we pour ourselves before God are oftentimes the moments where we feel like he's the farthest away. And I think that statement in this song is about that feeling, like he must not be here. And when you can't even deal with yourself, when you can't even be present with yourself, when it's hard to look in the mirror, you know, it becomes hard for us to know that God is right there in that moment. It's kind of like when I was a kid, if I did something wrong and I kind of had my head down, the last person I wanted to look at was my father. And you're all shaking your head because you know probably exactly what I'm talking about. It's like, I can't look. Ugh. That face, it's gonna, ugh. But the reason I find that moment where you lay your soul bare to be the most liberating is because God does something so beautiful and so amazing that we don't even expect. It's when we pour ourselves out before him, when we just get on our knees and say, God, here's my soul, we find out not only is he there, but he's always been there. He's always been there. And the only reason we couldn't feel him is because we couldn't look. The only reason we couldn't see him is because we couldn't get our eyes up to look. So I'm asking for you to join me in prayer as we sing this song. Find me in the river. Find me on my knees. I've walked against the water. Now I'm waiting, if you please. We've longed to see the roses, but never felt the thorns, and bought our pretty crowns, but never paid the price. Find me in the river, find me there, find me on my knees, my soul. Find me in the river. Find me on my knees. I've walked against the water. And I'm waiting, if you please. We didn't count on suffering. We didn't count on pain. But if the blessing's in the valley, then in the river we wait. Find me in Almighty God, do something amazing in this moment. I know that there are many of us who feel cracked and dry, even right now in this moment, for different reasons. It could be from our own sin. It could be because we're tired of ourselves. It could be because of loss. It could be because of grief, frustrations. But Lord, I am so grateful that you meet us in those places, that you don't forsake us and don't abandon us, even when we've abandoned ourselves. Even when we've forsaken ourselves, Lord God, but there's a beauty in your gospel and in your word that when we deny ourselves and pick up our cross and follow you, Lord God, we receive freedom. Freedom. Almighty God, speak to us in this place. Give us the courage to look at the hard stuff in life. The stuff that's going to shape us and grow us, we ask in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, everyone. Tony, you want to come up and give us a word for the offering, buddy? Yes, online, everybody saw this.
It was powerful, I'm telling you right there. It was powerful.
I tell you what, I hope online they can read sign language. You know, I'm just going to echo what Pastor Don often say, that God loves a cheerful what?
Giver.
When we understand the principles of God's timing and our giving, then we would understand why God wants us to do what we do, because everything that God asks of us is something that God has already given us. Amen? God is not asking you to give anything in and of yourself. He's asking you to give back a little bit of that which he has given you. You know, this week you didn't go to work because you felt like going to work, because God gave you strength to go to work, to earn an income. And God is saying to you today, just give me just a little bit back to invest in the kingdom. Amen? God loves a cheerful giver, and I pray today that God would touch your heart and you would have the vision of the kingdom of God and ask it to advance. And if many of you that started out with Pastor Ryan and you look around, the church has truly grown. And when the church grows, the need of the church grows. Amen? So we want to be a church that is able to supply whatever needs the church may have, whether that's being administrative or family. Hold on, Pastor Don might be calling me. Amen. So let us pray today. Father in heaven, we just thank you for what you have done for us and the seed that you have supplied unto us. I pray, God, that we will get this revelation knowledge, Lord God, in our giving and understand, God, that you will give back some 30, some 60, some hundredfold as we give today. I'm going to ask the ushers to begin to come down, and as they come and make their way towards the front, they will hand the trays out among the congregation, and you guys give as liberal as God has placed on your hearts. Amen? I'll leave it in the hands of the ushers. Father, I ask in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus Christ, God, that you would bless this offering. God, bless those that had a heart and a willingness to give. God, I pray, God, for those that had a desire to give but could not give, oh God. May these offerings, Lord God, be used for the advancement of the kingdom and used, for, Lord God, for the betterment of this church. And all that is said and done in this place today, God, we give you the glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen.
You guys can go. They came before we sung the doxology, but we are not going to miss it, so stand up. Because we don't need to have plates walking down in order to sing praise God from whom all blessings flow, do we? Amen? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. You may be seated. Junior worship. Outhead the youth. You know, I'm going to tell you something about the doxology. That was something as a kid that I just, we sang every Sunday, you know, praise God from, and I can remember growing up thinking, we sang it, you know, every week and so many times that I just would kind of be looking at something else, you know, especially as a kid. I might be taking one of the remember the cards in the front pew and with a pencil and praise God from, and, you know, playing tic-tac-toe with myself or something like that, right? But as I've gotten older, I've come to hear such a beauty in the simplicity of those words. And there is beauty in simplicity. Praise God from whom every blessing flows. Praise him, all creatures here below. If the rocks could cry out, they would say, Hosanna, Scripture says. Praise him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Sometimes in simplicity, hearing your voices ring out, there's a beauty in that. Amen? What I'd like to do, I'm going to ask Jim if he would come up and pray for the message today. And Jim, before we begin, I'm asking us all to be willing to tackle a hard subject today. Okay? I'm asking every one of us to take a look inside, because the temptation whenever a hard subject comes up, it's usually sin or dealing with conflict and personality things. The usual get-go is to look at somebody else besides yourself and be like, boy, if they could really get the words that Jesus was saying, boy, this relationship would be a lot easier. Oh, there's such a great temptation. Okay. Oh, if my spouse would just get this, ooh, it would just be so much smoother. Oh, if my children would just understand this, it would be so much smoother. If my boss would just understand this, it would be so much smoother. If the person three rows back to the left would just understand this, I could have a muffin with them at fellowship hall a lot easier. Today, you just waved to somebody. Were you calling somebody out? Today, I'm asking you and me to be willing to hear the hard stuff and see if something beautiful can come forth from it.
Conflict resolution. We come before God right now, and I'd like to have each of us just take a second. In any conflicts that we have in our life, I just pray that you would just ask for forgiveness and ask God to change our hearts in those conflicts. Sometimes it can be a really hard thing, but anything is possible with God. Soften our hearts. Help us to forgive those who have wronged us. Help us to change that we may seek God in a better way, in a pure way, with a pure heart. Lord, I just ask you to be with Pastor Ryan today as he preaches conflict resolution. Father, just open our hearts, open our minds. I just pray that your Spirit would just fill him, and the words that come from him would touch our hearts. Bless this time, in Jesus' name.
Conflict resolution. Oh, what fun today. You might think, this sounds like a managerial business meeting, right? But alas, Jesus has some words about it. So, we will undertake them. Walking in the newness of life is our series. The newness of Christ. And in walking in the newness of Christ, if you really want to walk new, if you want your life to be different, you have to be willing to go into the dirt a little bit. You got to be willing to face the hard subjects. Everybody been raising our hands the last few weeks, all on fire for walking in the newness of life when the topic has been about victory in the Lord. Amen? Yeah. We've had our hands raised about victory. He's going to overcome all our struggles and our battles. Amen? Yeah. Will you be as enthusiastic about walking in the newness of life when Jesus comes alongside of us and says, I need you to walk in this area a little closer to me? When it's not just about, okay, Lord, you're going to overcome everything, so I'm all set. And he does overcome our battles. But I think the Lord asks us at times to go into the hard subjects that might make us feel a little uncomfortable. And I would even go so far as to say, the more uncomfortable the subject matter, the more potential for growth. The more uncomfortable the subject matter, the more potential for growth. Because growth requires resistance. Resistance. Let me give you a silly little example. Does anyone know what this is? A resistance band. It's not a very heavy-pounded one. It's easy, okay? But what's the purpose? Jared, what's the purpose of a resistance band? String it on a banjo and make some music. I didn't think of that. It's to build strength. How does your body build strength? By encountering resistance, right? And so people go, have you ever seen them at the gym, and they're, you know, like this, and doing their things, and then they got them like this, and they're doing all kinds of things, right? And whether it's free weights, or whether it's resistance bands, or whether it's dumbbells, your body grows stronger from resistance, does it not? Well, what if the same was true emotionally and spiritually? That as you encounter resistance, you have the greatest opportunity for growth.
And if we never preach about resistance, if we never talk about resistance, how are we ever going to grow strong in the Lord? Listen, brothers and sisters, we have to learn how to deal with confrontation because it always happens in community. I felt called to preach this topic to prepare us as we grow. Not to root out something, but to prepare us because our numbers are growing, and as we grow, the potential for conflicts increases, right? Relationships as they grow, right? The honeymoon phase. Anybody been married and remember the honeymoon phase? How long did it last, right? Before you had to realize we better learn how to deal with confrontation. And so I would rather preach this now, and so we're prepared as we grow, than to ignore the topic and have us bite it later. We have to deal with confrontation. People trigger our insecurities, don't they? Come on, everybody. Let's be real today. People trigger our insecurities. And the ones that we have personality clashes with the most are oftentimes the people who trigger our deepest insecurities the most. There's some things people can do, and I'm like, ah, it's no big deal. There's other things people do, and I'm like, Those are the ones that touch on my own insecurities. Listen, if you can't handle conflict or confrontation, you will not grow. If you can't handle resistance, okay? If you can't handle resistance, you won't grow as an individual and as a community. You must learn how to deal with, I must learn how to deal with confrontation in healthy ways. And before we get into the scripture today, I want to give you six unhealthy confrontational personality types. Pastor Ryan's six unhealthy personality types in confrontation. The first one, and now listen, you can have more than one. Okay? I know I've got a couple, and I know it oftentimes depends on who I'm with, which one comes out. And if you're gonna tell me you don't have any, I'm calling your bluff right now. I have yet to find anybody that's ever lived on the planet except Jesus Christ who has mastered the art of confrontation in all circumstances with all people. Amen. Amen. The first one, the dictator, whose job is to execute and chop down all confrontation and stamp it out from the get-go. You may have people in your life. You may be that person in your life when confrontation or dissension, why is there smiles coming over here in the pews, right? Comes, it's like, I am going to lay that thing to waste right now. I'm not even going to let it surface up. That's the dictator. The narcissist will engage your dissension or your confrontation, but will belittle you to no end and make you feel ridiculous for even bringing it up. The passive person is going to ignore it and hope that it simply goes away. Maybe if I ignore this problem long enough, it will disappear. The passive aggressive person is going to pretend that they're ignoring it and find a way to get you back. They're also known as the vengeful. This next one's one of my favorites. The staunch defender. I mean, as soon as they encounter confrontation, they go on the defensive. If the dictator's on the offensive, the staunch defender is on the defensive. They're digging their heels in. They're ready to tell you every reason why it's okay, what they did. And they're just going to defend. They're not even listening to you because they're just defending themselves. And then finally, the sixth is the fearful, who is absolutely petrified of conflict. Petrified of confrontation. And like the pacifist, will bury it so low until it explodes. In other words, if you take these, the dictator, the narcissist, the pacifist, the passive aggressive, the staunch defender, and the fearful, I'm going to give you my words to substitute, and I want you to think of where your default is. The violent bully, the nasty, the quiet submissive, the vengeful angry, the defensive, and the afraid. Where do you fit? Because in 20 years of doing this, I haven't met anybody who could say I don't have any of them. I know, like I said, I've got a couple of them. My wife, she's working today. She got called into work. But I know she would be amening me right now if I was to say I have a few of them. You didn't need to fill in for her, but thank you. And I guess my question is going to be this, as we think about this. Right? Why are we so petrified of confrontation? How many think the word confrontation sounds like a nice word? Not one hand in the room. What does it mean? To confront. The prefix con, you're getting an English lesson, means to bring with. The word front means the front. All confrontation means, all to confront means, is to bring something to the front. What if it meant in confrontation, if we can do it in a healthy, loving way, I love you enough, Darren Roy, to take what I've been holding on back here and bring it to the front so that we can grow stronger. We have to reshape our understanding of this word. And Jesus is going to echo this, that we can grow spiritually, we can grow emotionally, and we can even grow relationally stronger together if we get a handle on confrontation. So, what does Jesus say? Matthew 18, 15. Listen, Jesus is going to give us a bullet-by-bullet chronological progression on how to deal with conflict and confrontation. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. Say this nice and loud for me. Between you and him alone. Wait a minute. Don't go tell everybody else in the neighborhood. Or how about this one? Don't go run and tell the church leadership or the pastor. No, we are not the first line in your conflict resolution. The person you have an issue with is. And if you can't tell them, if you can't love and respect them enough to confront, to bring with to the front, then you have no business saying it to anybody else. None whatsoever. And listen, what's the goal of this? If he does not listen, right? Oh, I'm sorry, jump. What's the goal of this? If he does listen to you, you have what? Gained your brother. The goal is resolution. The goal is not to make that person feel terrible. The goal isn't to bury them. It's not to be the executing dictator or the narcissist or the nasty or any of them. The goal is relational victory. If we're going to be serious about overcoming in Christ, we've got to be willing to face conflict. We've got to be willing to face hard topics like this. The goal in doing this, in loving someone enough to say, I'm going to bring this to the front because it's bothering me, and I care about you and I care about us. The victory in this sermon is you won your brother back. Is it worth it? Is it worth it? Now, you may say, well, what happens if they don't listen? Good news. Jesus is going to address that one too. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. Notice, it does not say if he doesn't listen, go slander his name from the mountaintop. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say go into work and tell everybody what a jerk you think that person is. It doesn't mean sit in the fellowship hall, drinking your coffee, eating a bagel, and telling everybody, oh, I'm not talking to that person today. It's take two or three people that you trust, right? Don't load the deck either. Don't bring your best friend who's going to side with you no matter what you say. Bring someone who's going to sit, because you may find that that neutral person has something to offer you, not just the other person. They may have something to offer you, not just the other person. Now, you may say, well, what happens if they don't listen still? Well, guess what? Jesus has got step three. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church, okay? Should be a pretty serious offense by now, okay? If somebody stepped on your rose garden, we don't need to bring it to the whole church, okay? If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and tax collector. Now, before you think you just got the right from Jesus, I went through this process. I confronted this person mano a mano. I confronted him one-on-one. I brought a couple neutral people. They're just not listening. I established it. I talked about it in a group. They still don't listen. Surely I get to not care about this person now. Really? Do you know who wrote this? In what gospel? This was written down in the Gospel of Matthew. Does anybody know what Matthew was before Jesus called him? A tax collector. How did Jesus treat the Gentiles and the tax collectors? He loved them anyway. The door is always open. What it means is, don't keep chasing the person around. It doesn't give you a right to not care and to not love people. Jesus says we even got to love our enemies. This is in the book of Matthew. He was a tax collector. Don't think as he's penning Jesus' words down, it didn't hit him in his heart. Jesus, I was at the bottom here. If you don't know what tax collectors did back then, they would take whatever Rome was going to tax the Jews at the time, and then they would add on a ton of money afterwards so that they could make a huge profit. They were despised in Judaism at the time. And how does Jesus tell us to treat them? To love them. To love them. To have a heart for them. Matter of fact, there's some great verses where Jesus looks at the religious fancy pants leaders of the time. And he says, prostitutes and tax collectors are coming into the kingdom before you because your heart isn't right. Don't think for a minute that's a license to hate somebody or to not care about somebody. Look at verse 18. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. How many people have heard that verse before? Where two or three are gathered, I am with you. How many of you knew it was about dealing with conflict? Right? Lou, I know you were on Tuesday. That was the thing that struck you the most. We use this verse, and there's nothing wrong with it, okay? If you're out just praying with somebody, and it's just two of you, all right, absolutely Jesus is there. But we only seem to use this verse when we have a big event and only two or three people show up. We go, well, you know, where two or three are gathered, Jesus is here. Let's eat. The verse is dealing with confrontation and conflict. You got to believe that Jesus is going to work in your life and the other person's life so that you win your brother back, so that you win your spouse back. You got to love people enough to deal with the hard stuff in life. And if the sermon is uncomfortable, that's okay. There's a reason that Jesus says this. Note the chain of progression. Do we really follow it? Do we address somebody one-on-one? Do we just bring maybe a couple neutral people who can help us out? Do we bring it to a group if there's a, and then will we still love them and leave an open door even if we can't chase them anymore? Because that's what Jesus is commanding us. You know, I always love as a pastor, somebody comes into the office and they say, you know, pastor, this person's really not following Jesus, and I really have an issue with da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And I say, did you talk to him about it? No. Well, you're not following Jesus either, because he just said what to do. This is about deeper relational health, to confront, to bring something out front. I'm not going to hold this behind you anymore. I'm not going to have the gotcha card in my back pocket for you. I'm going to remove my defenses, remove my fear, and I'm going to care about you enough because I care about us. Us. Imagine a community, brothers and sisters, where we lived like this. You think, if I said imagine a great community of faith, what would that look like? People would probably go, oh, a place where there's no issues. No, that's the trap. There's not a marriage that exists like this. There's not parents and children that exist like this. There's not jobs that exist like this. This side of the kingdom of God, that's not, if you're here and you're new today, guess what? We're not a perfect church either. True relational health isn't a place where there's no issues. It's a place where we love each other enough to deal with them and move forward hand in hand. And that, brothers and sisters, on this side of heaven, is victory. Yes. That's victory. We got it wrong. We're being trained in all our relationships to think that if there's issues, it's that the relationship's terrible. No. Jesus gives us a better way. He calls us to a greater calling in our life, to the dictator, to the one who wants to execute everybody who has anything different than them. And you know those people too. Jesus says, they continued to ask him, and he stood up and said, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Dictators in the room, do you live like that? To the narcissist, he says, you hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Do we live like it, narcissists? To the passive who says, I'll just bury it and pretend it's not there. That is not true relationship. That is not authentic community, and that is not genuineness. And Jesus says, there's nothing that is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Love the other person enough to bring it forward. To the vengeful passive aggressor, Romans 12 says, beloved, never avenge yourselves. Don't keep the gotcha card in your back pocket waiting to take them out. Oh, yeah, no, there's no problem. Yes, I understand. Thank you for talking to me. I'm going to get that person. Woo, wait. They got them something coming to them. Never avenge yourself, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not overcome by evil. Say this with me. But overcome evil with good. Say it again. Overcome evil with good. Say it louder. Overcome evil with good. To the staunch defender, Scripture says, he who is often reproved yet stiffens his neck, hardens himself, will suddenly be broken beyond healing. Doesn't sound too fun. There's a lot of people who can't take conflict at all without rising up, and they have been some of the most broken people. And I've been like that myself. And to the fearful, who's so afraid to bring it to the front that they're like in panic. Some people literally go into about a full-blown panic attack just from conflict. Hear what the Lord says. You did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. We are church family. We have a common bloodline in Jesus Christ. We have a common Father in heaven. Will you love your brothers and sisters enough to say, I'm going to put my fears aside and talk to this person from my heart because I care about them and I care about us. And resistance makes the relationship stronger. So what am I going with this? Well, before I close, I want to tell you I'm proposing a covenant in this church. A covenant with each other, and I'd like to talk more about it. I'd like to work with even with the leadership. You know? Now, that word probably scares you, and no, it's not the type of thing where we're going to ring people through the courts, the covenant courts. I'm talking about just a covenant of the heart. First, to humbly love each other enough to confront whatever you're holding on to. Care about the other person enough. Now, a couple little qualifications. This does not mean you have to bring everything on the planet that you don't like about somebody to their attention. Yeah, no. Listen, nobody wants their inventory taken, especially when you haven't done your own inventory. This isn't about, well, you know, I heard Pastor Ryan's sermon, so let me just go up and down on you and tell you everything I don't like. You got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them. You got to know what to bring forth and what to let go. And the question is, how do you know? How will you know what it is you need to confront? And the answer is, you'll know because you're carrying it too long. And it's weighing your relationship down. You don't have to pick apart a person. That's not what we do here. Judge not. This ain't a place to judge each other. This is what is on my back with this person that is weighing my relationship down, and I need to bring this forth to set us free. If the goal is not to have relational wholeness and relational healing, then and you're still just carrying it around to run their inventory, you are closer to the dictator than to the words of Jesus. The goal is to be set free in your relationships. You'll know with discernment from the Holy Spirit what to bring forward because you'll get tired of carrying it. That's when you know it's time. That's when you know it's right. Be humble. Take your own inventory first. Listen, here's another one. Don't have any agenda. You might not get your expectations met. You ever go into a conflict resolution with an agenda? If this person gets on their knees and tells me that they, you know, they did this and they did this and that they're no good, well, then I'm going to shake their hand. Your job is to bring it to the front. And if that happens, you did what you needed to do. You can't control people. They may say, I don't like that, and walk away. You got to love them anyways, because you don't know what might happen a month, a year, or 10 years down the road from it. Your job is to bring it forward, not to control them. If you watch your expectations. Have an expectation of yourself. Be humble. And don't bring everything you ever needed to say. Bring the thing that's weighing your relationship down. And don't forget to forgive. You know what verse comes right after the passage in Matthew that was our scripture lesson, where Jesus says, you know, talk to him first, then two or three, then the bigger group of the church, leadership or whoever. And, you know, that whole scenario where he gave us how to deal with each other in conflict. You know what verse comes right immediately after? Right where we stopped. Let's pick back up. Then Peter came up and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me? Now, remember, he just got done saying, if your brother sins against you, go and talk to him. These are related. They're meant to go hand in hand. How often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? And Jesus said, I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times. That's a symbolic number. Don't think that you got to 76 and you got one more. Right? That's not the way it works. And the second thing that I'm proposing in this covenant with each other is that we humbly receive what another might say to us. Sometimes this is the harder one. Don't defend yourself. Listen first. As a wise saying was, you've been given two ears and one mouth for a reason. Listen first. Love the other person, even if you disagree. Love the other person enough to hear him out, because you may find a point of contact. Admit when you're wrong. And this is a big one. Don't hold on to what the other person just let go. If somebody loves you enough, Jennifer Holloway, to say, I've been holding this on, it's been affecting our relationship, I need to set it free because I want us to be free, and you take it and you start holding on to it, the goal is relational healing and a community that, while is not perfect, is whole in Jesus Christ. Receive what someone might give, because the Lord may use it in ways you don't even know. Some relationships are a real hard workout. Listen. Some relationships are... But resistance makes you stronger. Resistance builds your character. Resistance grows your relationship. Resistance is what the Master has called us to do. There is nothing wrong with a relationship that gets a workout. There's nothing wrong. Get that in our heads, because every time we have conflict in this world, people go bye-bye. And I'm tired of it. Every time people have confrontation, they leave. A healthy and strong relationship gets a workout. It hits the relational gym, and there's no shortcut. There's no shortcut. And people quit too early, and they never get to see the beauty of what could be created. I say this sometimes when I do weddings, right? In beforehand, when I do premarital counseling, okay? I say, listen, you're going to have really hard times. There's going to be times you want to throw in the towel. But listen, if you can love each other enough and let and realize that God might be using each other to help make you holy, not just happy, if you can get through that, the goal is that 50 years down the road, you look at each other, you know what each other's thinking without even having to speak. But you can't get there in a shortcut. You got to be willing to let the relationship get a workout. Lou, I love that one, buddy. Now listen, I'm going to sum this up by saying two simple things, and then we'll end. I want you to remember the goal is to win your brother back or your sister back. The goal is not to win the argument. If you come with that expectation, you've already lost. If you come with the expectation to win the argument rather than your brother or sister, you've already lost. The goal is not to make someone else look bad and you look right. The goal is to find something righteous. The goal is not to be right. The goal is to find something righteous. To love each other enough that we don't carry around resentments. And brothers and sisters, if you forget everything I said today, every single thing, okay, Jesus had a step-by-step process, somewhere, I'll get it from the pastor later. I want you to remember this one thing. As you think about what it is you might carry against your brother or your sister, the resentments that people foster, I want you to remember what Jesus carried for you, so that your relationship with God would be whole. Remember the cross that Jesus carried. The cross that asks us to examine ourselves. The cross that confronts our sin, not to beat us down, but to set us free. Confront us with our sin. Confront us with our brokenness, not to highlight why our relationship is fractured with God, but to make it whole again. As you carry something against your brother or sister, you remember what Jesus carried for you to win God's children back. Let's pray. Lord, I know it's an uncomfortable topic, and thank you for it. Thank you for it. I don't just pray for everybody here, I pray for my own self. We're all in this boat together, but thanks be to you, you're in it with us. Help us dream about a community that's not perfect, about relationships that have issues, but about a love that is willing to deal with it and move forward in health. And then, Lord, when we dream about it, let it turn to action. Give us discernment on the things to bring and the things not to. Give us a heart of forgiveness for each other. Give us resistance, God, if it'll help us grow stronger. I know that seems like an odd prayer, but Lord, if it helps us learn to deal and to find health, then give us the resistance that we need, that we have opportunities to grow. In Christ's name.
I want you to take this communion cup because it represents exactly what we were just talking about. By the way, you might want to get these things started now, because I've seen people go for 7 minutes trying to get this top film off. Now, I mentioned something at the end of the sermon today, if you remember. I said, be careful of the things you carry to hold your brother down, because Jesus carried the cross to set you free. And with that, he took the bread and he said, listen, soak it in. Soak it in. This is my body, which is broken for you, to make you whole. Do this in remembrance of me. And afterwards, he took the cup. And he said, this is the cup of the new covenant, which has been poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins, for the forgiveness of sins, to reunite you and Almighty God. Drink of it. We're told in scriptures that afterwards they sang a hymn, and so will we. Please rise.
Nah, yeah.
Other back. The enemy does not want that, but he does. Whose way will we follow? God bless you all again. We're going to have a time for prayer, prayer for Jennifer, prayer for anybody who has needs just to come forward. We're going to gather around in prayer, and I just want to encourage you in that. We're going to give it a minute or two, but just know that if this topic resonates with you and you'd like to gather to prayer, we're gonna bring a group down.